Hi guys, we're here in Prepared 3D today. I'm going to be starting another tutorial in this one. We're going to have a look at the VRS Superbug. I'm not going to promise that this one's going to be quite as in-depth as the PC9s, but we'll see how we go. So, to begin with, we are cold and dark. And we're just going to start by taking a look at our consoles moving from the left up, down, and finishing on the right. And what actually works and doesn't work in here. And what it means. So, starting off, we've got no antenna selection on here at all. Normally, in the real aircraft, you've got an upper and a lower antenna for your comms, and also for your IFF. Doesn't work. Cipher, what manual transmits your ILS manual channels, and down here is if we can get the camera to play nice. And down here is our crypto, normally, our mode 4, which strangely on here works, but I'm fairly certain in the3D cockpit here. Okay, the mode 4 now does actually work. Then we have our volumes, running down here. There's various intercom volumes for your headphones and the like. Got our circuit breakers up here for our flight controls circuits, our APU and our engine crank, our rudder trim or flight control surface panel, rudder trim with our takeoff pushtard, the override and normal cover for it. Next we have our fuel control panel, so we can extend our fuel probe and select what mode our externals are in and if we're dumping fuel. We then have our gentie control for if you need to do a reset. Now the big one here is on this next one, is we actually have a couple of things behind here. We've got our inner, this is our exterior lighting panel. And as you can see, we've got our inhibit on normal, our strobe on normal through to F, our position lights on and off, our formation lights on to various intensities, and whether or not the light is actually, the strobe light is on or off. We have our throttle quadrant. We have our external power panel just here, and you can actually use this to get ground power should you so wish it, like so. For the moment we're going to leave it off. You have your test panel for brake pressure and your fire testing, your hook bypass, and I keep forgetting we actually need power to switch that to filled. In the real one, as far as I'm aware, you can actually flick it up and it doesn't immediately drop back to the carrier, but oh well. Our landing and taxi lights, our anti-skid, our launch retract bar. The launch retract bar is this little bar on the front of the aircraft. So if we bring up an exterior view here and we'll just go out to a spot. This is your launch retract bar. It's used to connect the aircraft to a catapult in the case of carrier launches. Underneath that we have our flap button, auto, half and full. If you go over, I think it's 250 knots, it'll automatically, doesn't matter what setting you have this on, it will automatically shift it and start moving. And then we have our selection of jettison button and panel. This is a micro switch. Turn it to where you need it. Hit the jettison. We have our landing gear panel and our emergency gear panel under here. It's hidden under here, I do believe. Can confirm that by having a look here. No, that's wrong panel. Looks like one of the few panels. The VRS doesn't have modeled in 2D. That's okay. Our canopy jettison, which will of course jettison the canopy. Emergency push to jettison button. Our master arm switch, our mode switch, our discharge button for one of our fire units. Our left engine fire warning, our master caution, our eyebrow caution warning on either side here. Our left DDI, our jettison station selection panel. So as you select this, it'll light up, and then when you press the jettison button, it will jettison that store. Our fuel control panel, I don't know, it's probably not the exact term for it, but that's basically what this is. The video record, which for the most part doesn't work. What mode you're in on your heading and track or course for moving it. The HUD, obviously. The go, bit and no-go lights. Our volume control and comm control buttons, which we will look at in a little bit. Our ident button, our brightness for the various screens, and symbology for the HUD and the light is here, as well as our AOA meter, our altimeter and our attitude, and our emissions control button. Our center DDI or map DDI between our legs with our ECM jettison button, our jammer controls, our RWR controls, our common missile warning system controls, and our dispenser controls. The ejection bar and our seat safety bar. Our good old steam gauge for speed, altitude, vertical climb rate, our RWR, our attitude indicator or horizontal, vertical situational display, indicator, whatever you want to call it, the bowl, our left DDI, right DDI, I'm not 100% awake, right eyebrow, right fire alert, FFIR, one here, and your APU fire alert there. Our IR or override buttons, our spin recovery controls, standby compass, our hook switch for controlling the hook on the back, our wing fold, hydraulic pressure, the avionics emergency cooling bus, and our warning panel, our battery meter, reset button, generator switches, and battery switch on the electrical panel here, the environmental control systems. So what mode you have it in, most of the time you're going to leave this in auto, the temperature cap of your cabin, which doesn't really affect the in here that much, our bleed air, engine, anti-ice, and the pitot, our interior lighting switches, and our lighting test, as well as our night vision mode, defog, and the like for if we had those, canopy open and closed, the air refueling system control panel, and our sensor controls, which you have the FLIR, and our laser systems, as well as our INS and our radar. And finally down here, does not work, so we don't bother about it. That is the basics of the VRS when it comes to the cockpit. So next we're going to move on in a moment to starting the aircraft. Okay, so no matter which version of the Superbug you have, FSX or the prepared one, you're going to have the document folder here. In the old FSX version, this will have a PDF most likely in it, which will have the flight manual for the F-18. It's a really good read. With the prepared version, and I'm presuming the FSX version, you can actually go in to the kneeboard here and bring up the checklist, and as you can see, apart from the fact that we can't easily resize this to fit what we want, we get the actual checklist here. So we're going to start with the interior checks. We've done a bunch of this, but we'll do this properly. So, left console. Circuit breakers are in. The manual canopy handle is stowed. Volume panel, well, we've got that as desired. Our flight control system is normal and guarded. Our APU is off. Our probe switch is in the retract position. Our external tanks are all in the norm, and our fuel dump is off. Our inner wing is in the norm. Our gen control, tire control is normal. Our exterior lights, we're just going to make certain the strobe is on. We're going to turn our position lights on and we're going to leave it in normal. Oh, actually no, we'll leave our position lights off. We'll use them as a way to signal that we're ready to move. Our throttles is off. Our external master is on. Throttle is off. Park brake handle is on. Landing taxi light is off. Anti-skid is on. Select position and unit switcher knob is to the off position. Our flaps are in the half or full. Our launch bar is in the retract. Landing gear handle is down. Canopy jetson is forwards. This is actually the manual canopy, but we don't use it, just so you know, back on the other one. Master arm is safe. Emergency jettison button is out. Fire and APU buttons are all out. Need to turn these to the off position. So, are they all in the off? COM 1 and COM 2 are in the off. Our altitude selection is where we want it. Our IR calling is in the normal, and I'll be right back. Our spin and switch is in the normal guarded down position. Our hook is up. Wing fold is in the spread position. And LIV cool is in the normal. ECM jettison is out. Cut is off. RWR is off. CWS is off. Dispenser is off. Oxrail switch, which is down here, is in the normal position. And the rudder pistols are as we want them. Right control. Circuit breakers are in. Gen switches to normal, battery is off. ECS mode is auto. everything else is off the fog, well, mid-range, but we don't have to worry about it. So normally you'd set this to here. Interior lighting panels as required. Mode switch as required. And these are all set. So, we're going to do an APU start at this point. Park brake is on and fully set. Our battery switch comes on. And we check the gauge, make certain we have the correct amount of amps. We're not using external power, so we can skip these steps. We want to do a...
Engine fire, left. Engine fire, left. Engine fire, right. Engine fire, right. APU fire. APU fire. Lead air, left. Lead air, left. Lead air, right. Lead air, right. Engine fire, left. Engine fire. Left. Engine fire, right. Engine fire, right. APU fire. APU fire.
If we look up.
Lead air, left. Lead air, left.
Everything should be lit up, which
lead air, right. Lead air, right.
So that's good. At this point, we verify that we don't have a caution light for our accumulator, which we don't. Bring our APU on. Right generator switch is on. Now bleed air in either the right off or off. Now, there's two methods you can do this part. Some people do it as crank the engine, then give the throttle. It says to move it to idle, and then do it. I tend to crank. Now we want to monitor the
flight controls. 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 Flight controls.
Now you may not actually get the flight control warning. This is interesting, I don't... that's right. Okay, so we have power to all of these. So, now we go to our engine display and we check. Normals. normal, good, and they both match. And we have a good lights test. So now remove this. Turn the APU off because we've got power from the main engines. Control from the main engine. Move the leader switch to the normal position. Move our engine crank switch to the left. Right, wrong. And you can occasionally do that. So, now we have to quickly restart the engine. That was my own fault, because normally I'm using track IR, but it happens. We'll flip the screens off real quickly here. We've already done the test, so when
flight control, it controls, flight controls, flight controls. 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 Flight controls.
Okay, move this back to the normal position. This time we're going to bring our throttle up to the 80% put both engines back to idle. So, for taxi checklist. But what we're going to do first is turn down prepared volume a little bit here. Okay. So normally you check and make certain you got your wake points in. and up proper. Radar will either go to standby or operational. This says upper, but normally you don't have it running on the ground. The other thing is, if you notice here, we've got no IR switch, because when this was originally written, this didn't do anything. So I'm just going to flick it across to nav. Now, this is in the spread. Our flight control system button push to reset. You should see this will go off. We still have a flight control system. There we go. We want to move our flaps to auto, push our trim button. Now, we want to bring this over to our, we can check some control panels here, but what we actually want is this one. Up stabilizer when we're in the center position. We want we're getting proper deflection. There we set our flaps. Back down to half. Okay. Seat safe. Sometimes the mouse look is annoying. So we want to extend the probe. Extend it back. We'll be yearning on that. We want to put our speed brake out. Check. Normally we'd have a guy on the ground telling us that they're up, but we can see our spoilers have popped. Hook handle. APU is off and verified. Standby ADI is correct. Oximeter setting is correct because it's got no weather loaded in. Oh god. So now we just need to check our bit page, which you can do by clicking bit. Then we are all go. So now we do our taxi checks and move out to the runway. So we're going to start our taxi check. And at this point I'm actually going to turn my track IR on. I'm kinda used to having it. Now you'll notice I've got my nose wheel steering here in with the ability to turn high and low on while down. Because if there's a point in the manual for the Super Hornet that states if you hold the button for longer than a certain amount of period, you can actually turn nose wheel gear on. It's got a little too high, that's actually what I meant to say, but of course, given we've got the canopy open, we don't want to go too fast here. We're going to... we could go all the way down to the end of the runway. I'm not. So, at this point, normally we'd already have some of this done. Let's skip the set. So, I'm just going to tell it on. We're going to tell 11183, which would be our local. We want to verify that everything here is correct. Park brake handle installed, and we're going to do our run up. Now, like all military jets, what happens next is fairly quick. We do our run up and we check everything is right there. Double check that we have the device trim. We've got no warnings happening during our run up. Normally, if we didn't have something, we'd hear a beady beady caution. At this point, we're going to come off brakes. We're going to go to our afterburner because we're going to do an afterburner. Take off here. I should have actually set my nose wheel steering to low before. I'm going to bring this up, gear up. And as we accelerate, bring our flaps up, and now we're just going to aim for 350. And to maintain a climb out rate of about 350 knots. But we're also going to come back out of burners, so we're going to have to bring the nose down. And you've got the big one here is on fairly heavy. If we have a look, I've got a fair payload on at the moment. So we are now airborne. And we could join up with our wingman if we didn't do a formation takeoff. We could go on our mission. We could happily bleed off a lot of airspeed that we really didn't want to because we weren't paying attention. And the like. But the other big one is, of course, at the moment I could not land this aircraft. We're way too heavy. So we're going to do what we do in real life here. We've got two options at Ambley. We could fly out over the ocean and dump ordnance, or we're just going to do it the easy way here. There's a nice lake. We need to burn off fuel, so I'm keeping the speed up, but I'm not actually going supersonic at all, because the law here in Australia is you don't do that over land, unless it's a military emergency. So, here we're going to, we also should have set our bingo, which, but it was already 3.5, which for me is about right. I'm going to select all stores. And then we're going to flick this around to the stores button. I'm going to fly out over the lake. And once over the lake, we're going to drop our stores. Master arm, which if we go to our stores panel, You'll notice that we got rid of most of our items. Including our satellite fuel tank. So now we're going to switch this back to safe. We could get rid of our wing mounts as well, but we don't need to. And immediately, if you're actually in the aircraft, you'll notice it handles a lot better. It's a lot lighter. Come back around for Ambly. Continue to dump some fuel. So, use my favourite method of doing this. What's happening now is we're streaming fuel from our tails. We're also going super. We're on the edge of the supersonic barrier there because we're a bit lighter. And we actually should have turned those on. So I'm going to close this out for the moment. I'm going to stop dumping fuel. We're still probably a little heavy, but we'll treat this as if it was an emergency. So Ambly is in front of us at the moment. We're going way too fast for a normal straight in approach. We want to pull 3G through this. We're already slowed below the 250 mark, which is good. We can use the G load off. Bring the gear down. Flaps down to half. We really should have done this as we turned base, that set there, but like I said, I'm treating this as if it's an emergency, so Tower would be able to let me know. So, if I hadn't have done it that way, what we'd be doing at the moment is we'd have flaps to half with the gear up. Coming to base, so we take base, check that we're through green. Which it says we are. We're on speed. But we've majorly overshot because I'm trying to do three things at once. So now we just want to keep it in the E bracket there. And of course, likely at this point you'd be going, sorry, going around. And down. Now with the Hornet, you'll notice I didn't try and hold the nose up. Some people try and hold it like this down the runway. The F-18 is a carrier plane, especially the Super Hornet. She's got the beefed up landing gear, she's designed to slam into a deck, and you might as well, and that's how she lands. So now we taxi back, we do our after taxi checklist, which is a fair chunk down here actually. And we shut down. But given this is at 52 minutes, I'm going to leave it there. In the next one we might cover the DDI and the like in a little bit more detail. Anyway, thanks for watching guys. Bye.